Okay, well, thank you, and good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out to hear our ideas, and we're looking forward to talking to you for a few minutes about our concepts for Navy Pier. My name is Jacinda McCann. I'm with AECOM, and I'm going to be the director in charge for this team and project in partnership with Bjarke Ingels, founder and creative director of BIG. Bjarke and I know each other pretty well. We're currently working together on the regeneration of Pier 70 in San Francisco, my hometown. So we see the Navy Pier's centennial evolution as a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity that will propel this city and regional destination into the future with densified activities organized around three bold moves, and we're going to talk to you about those. And we call this idea Pier 1, shown here on this slide, because we see Pier 1 as building upon what is already in place at Navy Pier, fantastic resources already there. Now, the ideas we're going to talk to you about extend a little beyond what was actually asked of us, but we believe the enhancements of this scale will be needed to enable all of you, the city of Chicago, to enable the Centennial Vision to be achieved and the goals of creating an icon and being truly world-class. So there's a great deal that's already working very well at Navy Pier. After all, 8 million people visiting the pier a year can't be wrong, and Navy Pier is, of course, Illinois' number one tourist and leisure attraction. But clutter and wear and tear and lack of clarity about uses and where to go and an overcrowded public realm during summer and an underutilized public realm during winter is pretty challenging. So we plan to make Navy Pier an exciting destination for Chicagoans and for visitors alike, and have these everyone commingle in an enhanced, active pier district with spectacular attractions that emphasize water and nature. Daniel Burnham made no small plans for Chicago in 1909, and so working with you all, the citizens of Chicago, and with Navy Pier, we want to design and implement refinements to the pier that build upon the best features while adding new elements that will inspire pride in this icon and compel visitors to come back again and again. So I just want to mention our team. We have a lot of people here tonight who have spent the last 5 weeks working around the clock on the project. I'm just going to name them. From AECOM, James Haig-Streeter, Megan Hart, Michelle Inouye, Blake Sanborn, Tarek Refai, and Martin Gordon. From BIG, we have Bjarke Ingels and Daniel Kidd here. From Spears & Major, Keith Bradshaw, who's going to speak. From Tivoli International, we have Jakob Crow. From Wet Design in Los Angeles, we have Timothy Hunter. From Project Projects in New York, we have Prem Krishnamurthy. From Lead Pencil Studio in Seattle, we have Daniel Mialo. And we have Eden Project on the team as well, as a whole team of local consultants. So what are the opportunities here? Well, the unique setting of the Great Lakes is a most extraordinary setting for the city on the lake, Chicago. And of course, we have the benefit of the grand thinking of the Burnham Plan, the most implemented of all of Burnham's plans, the City Beautiful Period, and this wonderful, wonderful network of parks along the lakefront, which is centered on the pier. We have the rich history of the pier, the beautiful buildings, this original early promenade, which was so powerful. And here we just have show you some slides here of scale, just to give you an idea of the pier's significance. It is the world's largest pier. You can see it scaled there against St. Petersburg and Yokohama, Chelsea and Santa Monica. It's a major thing. Now, just a little bit about AECOM. We focus on cities. We're working in cities around the globe, from Beijing to Sao Paulo to Moscow. London just finished the planning and the implementation of the London Olympics. This is a photograph of the public realm that we are working on at the World Trade Center. This is the regeneration and renewal, revitalization of Pierhead in Liverpool. This is by day, this is Pierhead by night. And this is work we're doing in Los Angeles with the Port of Los Angeles, creating a whole new waterfront, 9 miles long, to connect the citizens of San Pedro back to their waterfront. And this is my hometown. This is San Francisco. and I've been working on a vision plan for Fisherman's Wharf, which is in San Francisco in the Bay Area, the biggest attraction there. And we just laid over Navy Pier to show a comparison in scale along the main Fisherman's Wharf street. And we've learned a lot of lessons of Fisherman's Wharf about how we need to create a strong experience for people at you know, 5-minute intervals along at Fisherman's Wharf. And so we're bringing these ideas to the project.
Yeah, and from Jacinta's hometown to my hometown, this is Tivoli, Tivoli Gardens at the heart of Copenhagen, which is essentially a theme park destination that has succeeded to become a sort of an urban neighborhood of my city. Also, some projects that have relevance for the Navy Pier. We did the harbor bath in Copenhagen that extends public life into the port. We've done these projects that mix different functions, for instance, an apartment building and a parking structure to create a man-made mountains of homes. Various forms of ways of inviting public life into a building here, a museum or an exhibition building where you can actually bicycle through the exhibition for very impatient museum goers. A public building on the waterfront where the roof of the buildings actually become a man-made dune landscape for fun. Basically just to recap the challenge here, the Navy Pier is in the summer quite challenged by being overly congested. And at the same time, the magnificent location actually has a disappointing view. The breakwater sort of blocks the horizon, and the pier itself blocks the view back to the city in many cases. And then finally, the public pier sort of gradually fades away and becomes kind of empty and partially public towards the end. So we thought, like, how can we sort of create a reality that really lives up to the poetics of the setting? And if we could sort of, in a way, repopulate the Lake Michigan for a new form of urban life in the middle of the lake. And the basic idea is, you can say, where Navy Pier through the last couple of decades have been bringing public life into the water of Lake Michigan. We propose that the Pier Plus would essentially allow the public to flow through and bring public life to the skyline of the city of Chicago, invading the roofscape of the existing pier.
So we're now going to walk through the master plan. This is the overall plan, and I'm just going to take you from left to right in segments. So starting with City Link, this is a very important connection back to the city and something where we want to create a great garden gateway to Navy Pier. Gateway Park, the next segment, we want to create a new front yard to Navy Pier for Chicagoans, and we see this as a green machine, and we'll talk more about that. The lakefront, where the city actually meets the water, there are a couple of fantastic opportunities there. A new headhouse plaza, we'll talk about that. Crystal Garden, we're going to create an aquaponic food jungle there, we'll talk more about that. Pier Park, we see this as the most happening place on earth, and we're extending the size of Pier Park, we'll talk to you more about that. Grand Stair, we're going to lift you up into the air so that you lift up to the sky and you look back at the spectacular views to Chicago. A sky deck, more space for people to enjoy recreational activities. Festival Garden, this extraordinary idea to lay out gardens over the roof connected to art. Shelter building, the beer garden, and an interactive fountain. And then at the end, at the east end, a new landmark, which we'll talk to you about, really worth the trip. And South Dock, a ribbon of fun. Central Spine, the upper deck experience. And then North Dock, extending the park into the pier. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about Gateway Park now. This is the gateway connection. And what we want to do is to really bring the doormat out. We want to welcome people into Navy Pier in a way that isn't apparent in this photograph. So what we want to do is bring the ribbon of playful wood decking out. Children can play, and this will draw people in. We want to bring in new landscape, and we want to get a clearer designation of different uses, bicycles, pedestrians coming through here. We want to make this a fun place on the way into the pier. We want to address the way people walk to the pier. We think that there's a better way to do it than currently. The right-hand diagram shows a very gracious curve that doesn't require crossing the streets. We want to improve the ideas for set down at the head house building, even more so with the addition of a wider plaza in front. This is what the head house drive looks like right now, and this is how we envisage it, with a much wider plaza where different activities can happen and where you can really proceed and get the full appreciation of the beautiful building. So this is our Gateway Park plan. It's a lot of details on here, but there are three things I want to talk about. At the top end of the plan, at the highest point, we're going to create a large stormwater treatment area. We want to keep the fountain in the plaza and enhance it. And then we want to improve the general landscape and garden character. And we think there's opportunities to bring in more trees and different patterns of trees and species to complement the ecology of the site. This is the diagram of the stormwater garden. We want to catch all of the water runoff from this place in this garden. This is where we propose to have it. And this is what it could be like. Not only a functioning ecology, but a fabulous place for children to learn about a nature. This is the existing skyrocket water feature and designed in the early 90s. And we think this occupies a very important part as you proceed to create this first processional experience coming up to Navy Pier. But we want to transform it, and we want to enhance it so that in summer, you look at this with these waving wands of water and color and enhanced pop jets, spectacular effect. And then in winter, we want to create this sort of iceberg edge with color on the water feature. And then as you move past that, you come into the Crystal Garden. And this is where the current view of the garden, and we want to create a second water element here. So as you come in, the sound of water washing across these walls, the sound of water waves will actually draw you in, and this beautiful experience of water coming down these walls will draw you up into the Crystal Garden. This is what the Crystal Garden looks like right now, and we were asked to turn it into more of a garden, and so we took that into a new direction, and we want to create an extraordinary aquaponics functioning area there that will have high-yield sustainable food production. So principles of aquaponics, well-tested, fish are in the ponds at the bottom. The water is then taken up to the top, and in this case it's going to be to a series of aquaponic columns, and then it will be filtered down and will feed the plants in the columns and then create this cycled loop. So here's our how we imagine this space to be, with 35 of these aquaponic columns, with edible food all up and down them, with an elevated walkway that goes through so kids and families can enjoy looking close up at pineapples and strawberries and look down on the fruit trees, and they get a juice drink in the juice bar. And so this is what this would look like, with aquaponic ponds in the bottom, trees and fruit trees, the walkways going through, these columns coming up. And then this is the food that would be grown here, could be used through the pier and the restaurants. So you could see it, you could understand what this is and see this cycling of food. The Eden project in the UK has been working with us on this, and this is the plant palette that they've developed with us. And because you have these different microclimates, you can have different plants as you go up the aquaponic columns. So it's going to be a very, very interesting experience as you move through. And this is how we imagine it would look from in front of the juice bar, looking down, seeing the fish swim around, seeing these beautiful aquaponic columns.
So the first thing that sort of greets you, either you sort of head into the head house and the hydroponic gardens, or you actually go onto the south dock. It seems like we propose to add a layer of sort of extroverted functions that can sort of animate the south dock. that will also take up a 40-foot wide part of the actual dock in the form of a boardwalk and bring it to the level of the pier park. And the same along all of the festival halls to create this sort of undulating landscape of boardwalks that actually connects with the second level. So this is the view, sort of you see like parts of the boardwalk dipping down into the water and parts of it sort of moving up to connect with the landscapes higher up. Here in front, like rather than having this sort of relatively blank facade, we imagine this sort of a landscape of undulating boardwalks would actually allow people to access programs on the upper floors that could spill out onto the terraces and also create shade for the boardwalk along the south dock. This diagram shows you the sort of the south dock is very busy. It performs a lot of services for the pier and also for the boats. And this sort of undulating line, this red line, actually indicates the different points of entry on the different boats. And as well, you have this sort of series of elements, like various necessary installations that actually perform necessary functions, and that creates this sort of messy, noisy atmosphere. And what we propose is to basically redesign all of these elements and integrate them into this undulating boardwalk as this sort of continuous experience that really goes from smaller furnitures to lamps to various elements for seating to create sort of a public landscape that has an incredible diversity of use, but that is sort of woven into this sort of continuous transformation of the boardwalk itself. Also, the different level changes can be incorporated, and the kiosks and ticketing for sort of providing access to the boats creates this sort of continuous transformation of the entire South Dock in a sort of continuous man-made landscape. At the end of the wide South Dock, we imagine a fountain where people can actually enter into the fountain and really get wet without necessarily jumping into the lake, and with these sort of exploding jellyfish of water. Having arrived either from the south dock onto the higher level or through the hydroponic gardens, you can see this is the 40-foot extra width that brings people straight up to the pier park. We imagine to continue this public escalation and bring people all the way to the roof of the Shakespeare Theater and the parking. In doing so, we imagine to incorporate the proposed extension of the Shakespeare Theater into this man-made hill that is comfortably sort of contained within the hill itself. We open up to create these sort of terraces that capture views of the skyline of Chicago, of the pier itself. And we imagine this sort of a gigantic stair that is actually divided into areas with steps for seating, areas with steps for walking, and finally a smooth slide. So essentially, this element becomes one of the most sort of visual and visible sort of extensions to the landscape of the pier, and from the outside, it's going to be a major part of the public perception of the new pier. Here you see how the theater is comfortably contained within the giant stair and how other programs can actually spill out onto the stair. At night, you'll see the activity and the life inside this like man-made hill spill out onto the pier park. As the sort of public spectacle, in this case, it's Times Square, the big red steps. So basically, like stairs have incredible purpose for like informal hangout spaces. And also, this is the current view when you go to the top of the parking. And in the future, it could be looking down over this public landscape, enjoying the activities in the park itself. In the winter, we imagine... in the winter, we imagine snow tubing. Could be sort of part of the stair. And having just returned actually last night from my ski holidays in Park City, I recently tested the technique and it's it still works. So essentially, rather than having a big piece of parking infrastructure in the middle of the pier to create this sort of a amazing new destination, and we imagine that several times a year, like big public spectacles could sort of invade this man-made hill, and the Ferris wheel itself could become the backdrop of this new exciting space. Moving on along rapidly, having arrived to the roofscape, we imagined that the vaulted ceilings of the festival halls could be slowly colonized by this sort of a series of garden tapestries. We imagined that the garden festival from the festival halls could actually spill up on the roof, and over a series of years, we would gradually create this sort of roofscape where you could have an ongoing garden exhibition. So for returning visitors, it would be like a new experience. And finally, we imagine at the end, we propose to simply tilt the end of the pier, dipping down into the water and lifting up, creating these steps that actually bring the life of the pier down into the water, where you can really touch the lake, creating a sort of an informal amphitheater for sort of public experiences. And finally, nested under the tilted pier, a sort of an amazing restaurant that captures the view of the lake. Sitting at the end of this tilted pier end, we imagine the pinnacle fountain is going to be a fountain that has the same scale as the lake itself. It can blow water up 500 feet in the air. And we imagine that with our proposed Pier Plus app, people would be able to actually take control of the fountain and actually themselves sit and blow water 500 feet into the air. The app is part of a proposed redesign of the Pier identity, including the name Pier Plus, and the proposal of creating a community for cardholders. We've made a series of scenarios. I'm not going to go through them. We don't have a lot of time. But maybe just one thing that could be interesting to look at, a user group called The First Date, arriving at the beachfront cocktails, moving along the undulating landscape to the Lakeview Terrace, have a wonderful dinner, hang out in the beer garden for a while, go back through the tapestry gardens onto the top of the hill, looking at the people and the pier, maybe going for a ride in the Ferris wheel, maybe renting a paddle boat, and finally crossing the big plaza to take off on a tandem bike from the tandem bike rental, making it the most hectic first date in the history of Chicago. But essentially, you can imagine like different user groups, and even like for an avid runner, this like three-dimensional landscape would be an amazing extension of the life on the pier. This brings it to the lighting and Keith.
Great, I've got a minute. So I think it's important to talk about the relationship between lighting and the leisure park. So what I want to do is talk really, really quickly about how, you know, in a sense, light is visible energy, and we have a responsibility to make sure that not only are we delivering a great-looking pier and a great-looking lighting scheme, but it has to deal with all sorts of things to do with energy and sustainability. So the way we would approach that is have a very holistic view of all the lighting on the site and deal with things as diverse as identity and security lighting from as many common elements as possible. We've broken the site down into major, secondary, circulation, kind of leisure activities, so you understand all of the lighting pieces on the site. And the way we've kind of imagined this is that this could actually be played with in a very kind of interactive, fun way, such that way by linking people to the card, the loyalty card, actually people could kind of have an opportunity to interact with the lighting on the site in a very kind of simplistic way. I mean, this is a project we did which was, again, looks incredibly high-tech, but actually the light is delivered in a way where the light is triggered by a garage door sensor on the left-hand side. So this is not high-tech equipment. It's just very, very simple ways of bringing people and light together. But I think the one thing we just want to really quickly talk about is this incredible, iconic vertical landscape landmark we have on the pier, which is the Ferris wheel, and how actually a very low-resolution screen built onto both elevations of the Ferris wheel could be used in a very playful way as a backdrop to performance, or actually, in a sense, could change with the seasons, because the one thing is, for us, we really want to celebrate the seasonality of the light in Chicago. But actually, again, you could actually interact with this Ferris wheel. And again, with your loyalty program, you could actually deliver messages, birthday messages, proposals, all of these things onto the Ferris wheel.
Okay, so with this, we're going to accelerate to the end, talk about sustainability, energy and waste, and water management. And then, just to close, we want to thank you very much for listening to our presentation.
Well, back in the Windy City.